here tonight to provoke the senses, evoke your emotions. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Cirque du Soleil, Mr. Sample at the Shoal.
We got a thing that's based on a kind of Latin rhythm known as the bossa nova, but it's not really bossa nova, but we think that.
Let's hear it again for the artist from Volta. Irene, Lee, and Philippe, thank you very much again. So one final thank you, and then you can go back and enjoy the bar and the food and the company. A lot of staff from both Toronto Portland's company and from Economic Development and Culture Division put time into organizing this event, and I would like to recognize all of them as well. Thank you very much for coming. I look forward to seeing you outside.
Thank you so much for coming. I want to also thank Mike Williams. He organizes that kind of musical and very sort of show businessy introduction for himself, and I guess I get one too, even though I'm not named Michael, because you'll notice if you look at the people who invited you here, there's Mike Williams, there's Councillor Michael Thompson, there's Mike Karolchuk from the Portlands Corporation. Everybody's named Michael out here, except me. But I'm happy that you're all here, and I'm happy that we're here with the in the Cirque du Soleil tent, where we're going to see a great show with a lot of talent. And speaking of a great show with a lot of talent, I just want to spend a couple of minutes talking to you about Toronto and its future, because you're very much a part of that, and my responsibility, together with my colleagues in City Council, and I gather that Councillor Kristen Carmichael Greb is here as well. I can't see anybody up there. I know there's some folks. I can see nine people sitting in the front row, and as far as I'm concerned, the rest of the applause came from a canned recording. But Councillor Kristen Carmichael Greb is here, and if there are any other city councillors, they should right now shout out their names. So I'll say, oh yes, and of course. But we're going to work together to make the right decisions now. And this is the part of the job that's not that dissimilar to business. I ran a big company, and I had the good fortune to run for one of the great visionaries of the 20th century, and one of the great entrepreneurs of the 20th century, Ted Rogers. And what his vision was, that's one of Ted's relatives out there applauding, but what his vision was is he could see ahead. And if I told you the stories, I don't have time tonight, but the stories of things that he identified 10 or 15 or 20 years before they happened, but he had a sense they were going to happen. And what you have hope to be blessed with in these kinds of jobs where you're helping to plan out a big city is that you're making the right decisions today for what's going to go on in 15 or 20 years. And this is a really important time for us. I mean, you heard Mike talking about some of the statistics that evidence our growth, and that evidence our growing reputation, and that evidence the magnet that this city represents for jobs and investment, and people who want to come here to build up their companies, but more importantly, who want to come here to build up their lives. And I think people are looking at our tech sector, and they're looking at our health sciences sector, the growth in our economy that Mike was referring to, and they're looking at our diversity. I had 125 people that I was pleased to host, and I'm sure some of our other officials met them last week from Jacksonville, Florida. They came specifically, not on a trade mission, but they came to see our downtown, because they're trying to develop a downtown that's alive, as alive with people and things going on as ours is. And they noticed all kinds of things about Toronto's downtown, but what they noticed more than anything else was the diversity of the city. And person after person, visitor after visitor, event after event, people notice the diversity, and they know not only are they people who are diverse in background, but they're smart people. And so what we have to do now is make sure that we take advantage of that factor that people do notice, that diversity, that incredibly deep and broad pool of talent, and make sure we have in place the kinds of foundations we put in place today that ensures the growth going forward and opportunity for every single one of those people, regardless of their background. And I guess the message from me to you tonight, and one of the reasons we have this event, we can't do this without you. We can't do it without you because government can only do so much. And there are things government tries to do that it shouldn't be doing, that we're not very good at, quite frankly. But having said all that, when it comes to the kinds of decisions, especially when it comes to the built form and the land use and the plan that we have to execute to have a great city where people can live and work and play and study, we need your partnership, and more so than your partnership, we need your ingenuity. We have, right next to this tent, the largest undeveloped piece of real estate in a downtown anywhere in North America. The people from Jacksonville went on a boat tour last week because they wanted to see the downtown from the water. It wasn't exactly boating weather, but they were gobsmacked at this huge piece of real estate, as big in and of itself as the entire downtown of the city is today. And of course, that represents to me nothing but opportunity. Opportunity for investment in jobs, opportunity for residences, opportunity for places to study and to play, opportunities to grow and develop things like our film industry, which I think must be a part going forward of what is here on the waterfront, without taking away for one second all the other uses that are going to be here. It's such an important industry to us, not just in terms of the number of people it employs or the amount of business it brings into the city, but what it says about us as a creative, innovative city, a city committed to the creative industries as well as to a lot of other things. And we are stepping up and doing the kind of thing government should do. You know, the three governments have stepped forward together and committed $1.2 billion to do the flood protection, without which we can't develop the lands on the Portlands, and in fact, we take away some of the risk, even up into communities like Riverdale, of a catastrophic storm that would flood out those neighborhoods. But it goes beyond the money that we put up. We have a planning framework that the city has developed in a way that it will open up new opportunities, will strengthen things like the film industry, will help us to create new residential communities and new recreational opportunities. And so I think when you combine the investment of the governments in the flood protection with the Portlands framework and things like the Gardner, the development of the waterfront of the Don Lands, we are going to see in this area of the city unprecedented opportunity for you, because of course many of you are people that are in the real estate or development or planning business. And I think the main purpose of tonight is to say, we need you to be our partners. We're going to act like partners, not like government often does, where we're somehow the overlords that know everything. We're going to act like partners because we need your ingenuity, we need your money, we need your talent, we need your skills, and we will do the job we should do, which is to coordinate all of that and to make sure that it is carried out in the public interest. I see one of my main jobs as the mayor, and one that I've been trying to address myself to since I took office, as to work with the other governments, to work with them to make sure we do things like the flood protection, and the investments in affordable housing, and the investments in public transportation that really represent the framework that connect people to opportunity, so people can live in the city affordably, so they can get from place to place in the city to access jobs and opportunities. And the fact is that our downtown core is growing like crazy. What's gonna happen in the Portlands is gonna be another part of that, but we have to make sure we spend the time and the effort and put the resources into making sure the city remains livable, that it remains enjoyable, that people don't feel left out or marginalized, and that people from all walks of life can enjoy the future opportunity that is Toronto. It's one of the reasons why I'm putting forward the concept of Rail Deck Park. You know, people say, well, it's some kind of a legacy project. No, it's not. It is simply a recognition of the fact that we need to have a new marquee attraction downtown that people from across the city and across the world will come to see. Look at what has happened with Millennium Park in Chicago, Highline Park in New York. These have become concepts that were rejected as too bold and can't be done and impossible. They have become iconic attractions in those cities that attract not just people from across those cities, but people from around the world. And I think that this can similarly be a transformative project for Toronto, something that people will talk about when they leave the city, find it another reason to invest in the city as a place that is livable and that does focus on the livability of the city and not just on, you know, having more buildings or more jobs or all those things, as important as they may be. If our city becomes way too expensive to live in or way too congested to live in or becomes too polarized between haves and have-nots, we will see a very negative consequence from that in terms of our future economic success and prosperity, and in terms of our status as we are now as a magnet that attracts the smartest and the best and the brightest people from around the world. You know, you may say, well, what does housing have to do with any of this? I had two very top people from Silicon Valley in my office 10 days ago. The first two or three questions they asked me in detail were about housing and the affordability of housing and the ability of the people that they want to employ in businesses they might move to Toronto or might open a branch office here, the ability of those people to live in the city in which they want to work, because they're seeing problems now in Silicon Valley and San Francisco with the inability to live nearby where you work. And so we're working hard as well at the supply of affordable housing, and I make no apology for the fact that I stood up for Toronto to the other governments to say they have to participate in this. They are the main beneficiaries in financial terms of our growth and success in this city. This city is the economic engine of Canada, as you heard Mike Williams reciting in his remarks, and we have to make sure the investment coming back to this city in areas like public transportation, like affordable housing, and for that matter, like flood protection, reflects not only the fact that we contribute way more than we get back, and we're proud as Canadians to do that, but that we get back the money we need to build this city out properly to make sure that it remains a magnet. And so I'll conclude simply by saying this. I think that this is the city of the future in Canada. And I say that, I don't say it to aggravate people who are from somewhere else, although I do relish my role as the one unifying force in all of Canada, because everybody likes to dislike the mayor of Toronto. But this is no disrespect. This is no disrespect to any of the other cities in Canada. They're great cities, and the very fact three of the five most livable cities in the world are Canadian is something to be proud of, and I think it reflects our values as much as anything else. But the only global city, right now, and could change over time, the only truly global city in Canada, Canada's champion, is the city of Toronto. I call it the greatest city in the greatest country in the world. And you know, it's a given occasion for some cheerleading. And by the way, there's a red light flashing now, which they told me means my time is absolutely up, and I think sort of a huge cloud of tear gas is going to come down here any moment. And I'm just waiting to test it out. Oh, it stopped flashing, so it must mean the threat is over. But ladies and gentlemen, we owe it to our country, we owe it to our city, to make sure that global city, that city of the future, that we take full advantage of that opportunity, that huge opportunity, that we stay as a magnet for people from around the world, that we maintain the values that have made it a magnet for people from around the world, and that we continue to create the opportunity that makes it a magnet above and beyond our values. And so I'm very sincere in saying to you, you are the partners that we need in the city and with the feds in the province to make that a reality. And this event is all about saying thank you and inviting you to participate in the next chapter as actively and with as many ideas and as much money as you possibly can. Because the opportunity is as big as anything that exists anywhere in the world, and I'm just privileged to be associated with the city at this point in our great history. Thank you very much, and have fun this evening.